the path of the plan or relationship. Here,
the left and the right.
Liberation is accepted. Mm. By these people, liberation is rejected. Mm. That's the thing. Here, the element of sacrifice starts. Mm. For example, Buddha or the Christ. Mm. Here, the two paths deviate forever, never to meet. Some people take this path and then they wait in the seventh subplane of the first lowest plane, and then there will be a delusion of this plane, then they will escape into the first subplane of the second main plane, then they go into the seventh subplane of the second main plane, they wait there thousands of years, then there will be a deluge of that plane. Seven times the deluge takes place to the seventh main plane, once the deluge takes place to the sixth plane. So they have to wait until then. Then they go to the, at the time of the second deluge, they go to the third main plane, first subplane. They have to cross and they reach the seventh subplane of the third main plane. Then after the seven deluges of the second plane, the deluge of the third plane occurs. Then they escape into the next. Like that, they have to escape a 7 × 7, 49 escapes to the first main subplane of the first main plane, Mahaparinirvanic plane. Until then, they are waiting like the bats on the ceiling at the house. You know the bat bird. That is what is exactly this comparison is given in the scriptures, that they are waiting, hanging like the bats, these people, until the total dissolution of the seventh plane. That means the lowest plane should have undergone seven delusions, then the second plane, then such seven delusions, then the third plane, like that. The seventh plane has its own deluge. Finally, it is called the plane of truth or the plane of creator, the seventh. But these people will be already there in that plane of consciousness as soon as they tread the path. That is what is given in the scripture. So, Tibetan removes all the background and use a sampling of the whole thing in his books, because the modern busy mind has no time to receive all. He gives a sampling.
Yes. Yes.
So this is for today.
But the application should be in sequence of each series.
Exactly according to the sequence given.
Of the sequence.
To the letter, it should be followed.
Not simultaneously.
This cannot be done simultaneously unless you cover the course sequentially. After you cover the course sequentially, you will have the simultaneity of all these things existing in you.
Now, when I said simultaneously, I was thinking of, for instance, the sun.
No,
and
simultaneous. Instruments working in the house, we should learn the engineering and follow accordingly. Otherwise, there may be an explosion of the fuses in the house, or the filaments may be burnt. Electricity should be used properly. If the insulation is faulty, there will be a short circuit. So in the comparatively advanced lessons, we have to follow the procedures to the letter. Is not included in Patanjali's book, because Patanjali's book deals with yoga practice and not yoga living. Bhagavad Gita includes yoga practice and yoga living. This is given in an applied manner totally in the Bhagavad Gita, and in the scriptures the detail is also given. This is how the plan goes. So today in the concluding lecture we have five important aspects to complete under the heading yoga living according to Patanjali main. One is your duty as your spiritual training and discipline. You should apply the simultaneity of consciousness to the daily routine and understand that your duty is not prescribed by yourself, but it is prescribed from a higher source. It is the impulsion your consciousness receives from a higher source having a plan for you, which is only a part of the total plan. In the 18th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, something is supplemented here. That is, yatah pravrittir bhutanam yena sarvam idam tatam. That is, from the same source, which is the source of the creation and the creative activity of this whole universe, which creates the cosmic egg, the solar systems and the planetary activities. It is from the source, same source, your earth planet is created and its activity is created, its biological kingdom is created, its humanity is created, your society is created, your nationality is created, your mentality is created. So that is the same source which gives impulsion to everyone and to you also. That is the only possible source. So you are expected to accept the vocation that is presented to you. That is your job, etc. If you try to make a serious attempt to change it according to your supposed understanding of convenience or inconvenience, then a change is possible in a temporary way and you will suffer a lot because of the inefficiency and lack of fitness of your vehicles to the work chosen by you unnecessarily, and that particular span of life goes a waste, and the same thing is to be repeated. That is what is given in the 18th chapter of Bhagavad Gita about this fact, duty, because your duty serves a double purpose. It serves to be the scientific process of cleaning your vehicles and training the ground to grow into the awareness of the real self. So nothing is to be complained against the order of things that is coming to you, and you should be able to distinguish between your own likes and dislikes and the sequence of things that is being presented to you by nature. Gradually you will get at this faculty, capacity, by following the practices prescribed previously. And another warning is given that the scientific yoga path should necessarily be only one path, and yoga cannot have two paths, because your externalization in the evolution has taken only one sequence, and your retracing includes only the same sequence in its reverse order of occurrence. So it takes the same sequence in its retracing order of sequence. If you pose to establish a new school of yoga, you can establish a new center or a new activity of working, but a new philosophy will get atrophied as philosophy and stands there. So all other systems in the world, they live only as philosophies and not paths, until you follow the one path. And this one path can be known through many religions or many schools of thought, no problem. But if you want to establish your own school of yoga, it will be a failure. That is also given. And here, you be careful of your mentality, saying, this is not my duty. Don't do vehement attempts to choose your own duty when your duty is being indicated. There is a story about it in India. A laundryman was having a donkey which carried clothes for him, and he was having a dog which was watching his house, and he was negligent about giving the food to the dog regularly, and the dog was a bit disturbed. And in the night there was a thief, and the dog was silent because it was reluctant about the master. And the donkey asked the dog, why don't you bark? The dog said, my master doesn't recognize my presence. I'm not intent upon doing my duty to him. Then the donkey said, I am a faithful servant to the master, I'll do it. Then it began to bawl out. The washerman woke up, and he never suspected a thief, because it was the donkey that was bawling out, not the dog. And he bet the donkey blue and black with a big stick. This is the story given in the Indian scriptures about the duty of a yoga disciple. You see, and if I do something in the kitchen, neglect doing the other duties and go away, if you go into the kitchen and find everything wrong, it is quite natural that you feel a bit disturbed, because I am negligent. But the duty of a yoga student is to do it with pleasure, because doing anything that is before you gives you a cleaning and a purification of your vehicles. That is the only remedy that can cure you of your complexes, is doing your duty on the manual physical plane. Otherwise, all other things can be cleaned, but not the complexes, psychological complexes. The only method to clean the psychological complexes is doing your duty, and doing the duties neglected by others. without any complaint, even to your own mind, silently. Sometimes appears meaningless. But it is only for yourself and your own training and your own discipleship that you have to do this. And if you do something useful to the world, forget about the usefulness to the world. It is only a process to clean your vehicles of your complexes. Because if you don't do it, someone does it better. Any useful work to the world. What if I do not do it? That means someone is there who can do better. So it's not for the benefit. The benefit can be had by the people through any instrument in nature. And if we happen to be an instrument, it is for the cleaning and purification of our vehicles from the psychological complexes. There is no other remedy at all to clean and wash our psychological complexes than this. This is the one aspect which is given towards the end of the yoga textbook. Of course, sometimes it may be a little bit difficult to compromise with this, but if you want to be a yoga student, you should have a happy compromise with this fact. The second thing given is about the three qualities: inertia, dynamism, and poise. Inertia, dynamism, poise. Previously, they were conditioning your five senses and mind. Either inertia will be more or dynamism will be more before we took to the yoga path. Generally, the relationship will be 3:3:3 in the buddhic and higher mental planes. But when we exist in the lower vehicles, and the one comes down either to this or to this. So 2+4+3 or 2+4+3, like this. No equilibrium. When the mind reacts to this and through the senses to the environment. If this is more, we are called lazy, lethargic, and irresponsible. If the inertia were to be the dominant factor in our nature, we do not feel like doing something which we are expected to do. And impulsions of nature make things compulsory to do. And in bondage we live, in bondage we do our work, because impulsions bind us. Suppose we sleep on the bed until we feel great appetite. The impulsion of the need of the body drives you out of bed. Then you will eat. That is called bondage. Like that, they will bind us, and this fellow will be a prisoner in the cage instead of being a master of the vehicles. And when once the simultaneous existence of consciousness in the three states, meditation, contemplation, and absorption took place, the need of the three qualities is gone, because it is only to train you to take a leap into the real self. They are working upon your mind when you are in the non-self. That is, it is only to give the compulsions that they are working. They are making you painful every time and making you try to be happy. You can be happy only when you are with your higher self. And they are every time creating their compulsions and pressures upon you in the form of the many miseries in the world, so that you try to seek solace. And we spend much time in seeking false solaces and finding it useless. We try to find solace in relatives, friends, money, luxury and all these things. But since it is false, the mind will not stop there and it still tries to take a solace. If you have a TV in your house, if I don't have a TV in my house, I am jealous. The mind tries to have a solace. Then I make an experiment by purchasing a TV, and the mind goes to something else, because it is not a real solace. Mind thinks of something which is not there with me. So we are making false experiments for solace. And then, yes?
What is the word solace?
Solace. Consolation. Excuse me. Consolation. Some words are not commonly used in some languages. So, this continuous trial and error method, trial and error method, through miseries, that is happiness and sorrow, pairs of opposites, these two things create such a peculiar sensation of discomfort between the pairs of opposites. That is, when it is too cold, we want something warm. When it is too warm, we want something cold. Like that, the impulsions of inertia and dynamism create a necessity for you to try for the poison. That is why misery is intended by nature as a lesson to the lower self or not self. And when once you take a leap through the poison into your real self, which is the positive core of yourself, then the need of the three gunas or the qualities is finished. The teachers can go to some other institute and give a lesson to a new recruit. See, in you the purpose is finished. So they have influence upon you no more. And then the picture will be like this. And the point of consciousness becomes It is a body of light where every point is a center. You will be a globe of light of consciousness with center everywhere, circumference nowhere. This is what Patanjali points out as the next point. And here, the three gunas continue to work in cooperation with the devas of who build your body. That is to build up the protoplasm in your physical body, to conduct the functions, vital, digestive, etc. So, except for the physical and the prana process, they do not interfere with you. Clear?
Who is this? Who doesn't interfere? The devas?
These three the prana qualities. The three qualities.
Who?
The three qualities. Guna.
Guna?
The gunas. Ka means qualities.
Guna. How do you
in
spell
Sanskrit,
that word?
In Sanskrit, we call them gunas.
Ah.
Guna means quality.
And poise is sattva.
Sattva.
Mm-hmm.
Inertia is tamas.
Tamas.
Mm-hmm. Dynamism is rajas.
Mm-hmm.
And
poise is an English word.
Huh? Poise, English. That means when you take a balance,
equilibrium.
Poise. Of the three qualities, poise is the one quality which opens the gates to your real self.
And you call that how in Sanskrit? Poise?
Sattva.
Sattva.
Sattva. Inertia is called tamas. Dynamism is called rajas. They continue to exist because they belong to the solar and cosmic and planetary mechanisms. They are not your grandfather's property. Therefore, they continue. They continue to build your body, to build your prana, but they do not interfere with your existence. That is the second point which Patanjali points out. The third most important point is about conditioning and habit. Previously, you were conditioned by the three qualities and your habits belong to a blend of the three qualities, an unequal blend, which makes your individual nature different from the millions and millions of natures on this earth. Because the blends undergo multiplications and mathematical progression infinitely, as many blends as there are numbers possible. So every one of us have his own or her own nature, which is quite different from the other. That is the blend. If you place salt, citron, and pepper, with these three things you can make thousands of blends if you are a good cook. Each blend differs from the other in taste. Similarly, every one of us have our own tastes different from the tastes of others on the plane of the not self. And when you go up into the real existence, then the force of habit and the conditioning, the blending exists. But it is not conditioning, but it is a blend which is universal. It is called the universal habituation. So from individual habit, you will recede into the human habit. From the human habit, you will go back into the biological habits, which is common with all the living beings. And you will retrace into the planetary habit of this earth. And then you will go back, retrace into the habit of the solar system, which has all the habits of all planets as petals. And then you go into what is called the cosmic habit. That cosmic habit overshadows your existence, and your existence is there overshadowed by the cosmic habit. That becomes your nature. The nature of the cosmos, that is your unit space globe, becomes your nature. What is the nature of the cosmos? It is to create. So your nature will be to create. You will have only the creative faculties and you become essentially positive in everything. That is, the negative quantities like doubt, suspicion, jealousy, sorrow, hatred, fear, they have no place in you. Because they are negative quantities, which are the anti-points of the true existing points. Just as we have anti-atoms in physics, we have also anti-universes to the universes. And we have also anti-space globes to the existing space globes. Each space globe exists millions and millions of solar systems. Just as each banyan tree consists of millions of seeds of the banyan trees. Each seed is a potential banyan tree which can germinate into a big tree. That is how the solar systems are built and the universes are built.
It is also said this, that the point of creation is absolute darkness, black.
Yes.
And what is coming out is light.
Yes, it is light. That's because it is darkness to our understanding. To itself it is light. So when we gradually grow into in our understanding, darkness is nothing but pure subjectivity. When there is one person to observe, then it is darkness.
Is this the case also on the physical plane?
Yes,
the
in
night,
every plane.
The night is not really dark?
The night is dark to our eye. To itself, it's not dark. Relative to your eye, you call it darkness.
Yes.
What we call darkness is darkness to us.
Yes, also psychological, no?
Our reaction is darkness. That's it.
And that cannot be changed, or can it be changed?
No. When we take the cosmic nature, what we call darkness now is light to us. It is a ray of light, the mother of light it is called, from which all the rays come out. Just as when you exchange a 100-pound currency, you will have the lesser papers for lesser currencies. It is like $1,000 currency, darkness. When you make an exchange, you will have the lesser currency which you call the spectrum.
Spectrum. Yeah.
What we call white light is a lesser currency, and what we call the spectrum is the much lesser currency.
Now, I think we can always see that what we are.
Yes.
And so far.
Yes.
If we are coming more and more into the deeper consciousness,
yes,
we can also see the other.
Yes, because you will become one with
yes,
that.
Exactly.
That is how.
Is
yes,
that the process of exchange, going into deeper consciousness?
Yes. You will be one with the $1,000 paper. Like that. So this is called overshadowing of the cosmic nature. You will be like a colorless glass totally, and the cosmic nature overshadows you. And your behavior is cosmic behavior. That is the next point he gives. And another clarification he uses is, when you are in the ordinary way before taking up the scientific yoga process, your physical body your mind your senses and the reactions all these put together. They will give a weight to the I am in you. Suppose there is a fulcrum. They are pulling you towards the gravitation of the two qualities, inertia and dynamism. When you take the effort of drawing yourself to the real center of consciousness, that is the Lord consciousness in you, here the process is most difficult because you have to climb with all the burden. As you go approach to the fulcrum, the process becomes a bit more tough, and when you reach the point, touch it, then it begins to take a tilt to the other side. All this weight will help you towards perfection.
This is in relation with the journey of the chakras.
Yes.
That moment of change.
Yes. Like that.
Yes.
Until you reach a point of illumination, you have to make the effort. And after you reach a particular point of illumination, you need not do any effort. It shows you the way from within and it pushes you smoothly. So you can enjoy the benefit of your effort of the first half during the training of the second half of the illumination of consciousness.
It's also to say the first step until the myth is, yes, power essential for finding the duty. Afterwards, the duty is coming.
Yes, because the habit helps you.
Yes.
The newly engrafted habit, it takes root and it becomes a tree. It helps you. This is one more point, Patanjali gives. It is called the fulcrum principle.
Fulcrum, what is fulcrum?
Fulcrum means the turning point in the balance. It's called the fulcrum.
Principle.
Yes. In Sanskrit he says Kaivalya Pragbharam. That is, Kaivalya means the one existence. Pragbharam means, bhara means the burden. The burden comes to the front and pulls you to the path. Until then, even the qualities of the physical body are sometimes burdensome. For example, the aberrations of disease, all these things, they work as impediments. Ill health, laziness, all these things, they pull back. But then they push you. Even when the body is not fit after a certain age, in the last moments, it pushes you to come out of the body in a sweet, pleasant way. Because it is a part of healing. To come out of the body when it is time is an essential part of healing. And if we do not know how to heal, we very much wish to live in the same body for some time more. That is what is given in the esoteric healing about death. Very peculiar passage is given, most essential to read and read and read again. it is about death, the chapter on death in the Isavritti. Nowhere in English literature till now you find such a scientific treatise.
About the Tibetan Book of the Dead?
Yes. No, healing, esoteric healing.
You cannot extract things from the Tibetan Book of the Dead because they are cryptic passages, the language barrier is there, and we find at many places the imaginations of the linguists who do not know sometimes the language. They have imagined many things and substituted their own strange thoughts about the text of the Tibetan Book of the Dead. So we have the Book of the Living instead of the Book of the Dead. That is the esoteric healing.
And also in Treatise of White Magic there is a lot
about...
That's why I said it is the last book to be read among the Tibetan books. White magic. Last but one should be the cosmic fire.
The last one.
Before. Last but one.
Before.
Last one should be white magic.
Yeah.
Because it is nothing but an editing and a rearrangement of the matter in all the books, all the other books.
Yeah. True.
When we gain certain amount of mastery in all the other books, then only we can know the beauty of the editing of the book White Magic. If we read the White Magic in the beginning itself, it will be something like Black Magic.
this is very interesting to explain it, because the teaching in the Arcane School is a little different.
Is it?
Yes.
I see.
Yes, they say the White Magic is a certain handbook for discipleship.
Yes, handbook to whom?
Yes.
To those who know how to read.
This is exactly now, you see.
You can say it is a dictionary.
Yes.
For whom?
Yes.
Not for an illiterate, but for a person who has read some books and who met with the difficulty of understanding certain words, it is a dictionary.
Mm-hmm.
But not to the beginner.
This is, I think, it's very dangerous. It's good to...
No. This is not at all the book to begin with.
No. It's true, one gets a different impression on reading it the second time than from the first time.
Previously, the book to begin with is discipleship. And now, the book to begin with is ponder on this. Because in the beginning there was no book ponder on this before the student worked out.
Yes.
Now, first book is ponder on this, last book is white magic, last but one is treatise on
cosmic fire.
I don't know that the Arcane School prescribes White Magic as the first book.
No, not prescribed, but if the, not the Arcane School, not what is given by Holy Spirit, but today, if people are asking there what they have to read, then the information is, not this is not the first book, the White Magic, but it is explained like a handbook.
Yes. During the past 10 years, what I was doing is, successfully, I prescribe, ponder on this to the person who is ready, who is questioning, and I will allow for 1 year to read for himself whatever headings he wants from the contents, so that the selection may be his according to the needed development of the consciousness.